Welcome, welcome. Hello, welcome everybody to day three of NATPE. What's up? Woo! Who had coffee? Raise your hand. All right, we need more coffee in this room, stat. All right, you guys are in for an awesome treat. Hello. Woo! I am Amber J. Lawson. I am your hostess for today's track. We are going to have an awesome, awesome ride. Just to give you a little background on me, I'm the managing partner at Storytech. We're bridging the gap between technology and storytellers. This track is 20 minutes with a visionary taking a deep dive into different topics. So I invite you to tweet this up, the hashtag NATPE. Tell your friends to come in and join you. This is going to be very fast paced. We're just gonna start churning them out, and you're gonna have awesome insight after awesome insight. And we're gonna get to chat about it in between each person's presentation. So I am not gonna be up here yammering on. I wanna introduce you to this guy. He is just really inspirational, and I think you will walk away with many nuggets of inspiration and direction out of this. He worked at Current for 4 years under Al Gore's, maybe I need some coffee, Current Television, where he was a host. He went off to start his own short form content. The Atlantic actually calls him a full-time walking and talking TED Talk. Also the Timothy Leary of viral video, which I love. His non-commercial short films have gotten millions and millions of views. He speaks around the world about innovation and technology and the human condition. Most recently, he is hired to host this new series called Brain Games on National Geographic that is premiering this spring. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce you to the wonder junkie himself, Jason Silva. Woo!
Hi, everyone. Thank you for being here. Really appreciate it. So I love that the theme of NATPE this year is beyond disruption. And, you know, we're all trying to make sense of these disruptive times that are sort of happening on the back of these exponentially emerging technologies. And people are always wondering, you know, how can we ever get used to this disruption? And the truth is that we can't. And the reason is that our brains, you know, our brains evolved in a world that was linear and local. We're used to making linear extrapolations about any kind of change. When we're calculating how far away a predator is before it comes over and attacks us, we're making a linear projection. But we don't live in a linear world anymore. We live in a world that is global and exponential. And so we have difficulty wrapping our brains around what that means, because these exponential growth curves that are riding on the back of these exponentially emerging information technologies are basically transforming the world as we know it. And it's not just media, it's pretty much everything. So the first thing I'd like to do is very briefly explain to you the implications of exponential progress, just so you can see the difference between exponential versus linear progress. My favorite futurist and friend, Ray Kurzweil, uses the famous 30 steps example to illustrate the distinction between linear progress and exponential progress. He says, if you take 30 linear steps, you go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 30 steps later, you're at 30. That makes sense to our brains. Oh, sure, yeah, 30 steps, you get to 30. But if you take those same amount of steps exponentially, you would go 2, 4, 8, 16. By step 30, you're at a billion in the same amount of steps. That's the reason why your smartphone today, where people are watching so much of their media content now, your smartphone is a million times cheaper, a million times smaller, and 1,000 times more powerful than what used to be a $60 million supercomputer that was half a building in size 40 years ago. So what used to be half a building now fits in your pocket. The supercomputers of yesteryear are now in everybody's hands. So beyond being a disruptive change in media, the disruption here is that, you know, individuals now have the computing power that only governments and corporations used to have. So what does that do? Well, for one, it empowers creativity on a scale we've never seen before. It means that a young person with a cell phone in Africa has better communications technology than the US president had 25 years ago. It means that mind-to-mind communication, media, technologically mediated telepathy is now a reality. We can send our thoughts from mind to mind across the world, transcending the limitations of time, space and distance. I mean, it means that we're essentially shrinking the lag time between what we can imagine, what we can conjure up in our imaginations, and what we can create in the real world. So obviously, this is a lot to take in. I've been fascinated by the implications of exponential growth ever since I read Ray Kurzweil's book, The Singularity Is Near, When Humans Transcend Biology. And he introduced the concept of the singularity to me, which is pretty much something that we're going through right now, or at least we're heading into. A singularity is a sort of an apex or a convergence that turns into a phase change. It changes everything we thought we knew. You know, when you go through the center of a black hole, that's called a singularity. The laws of physics no longer apply. And we're seeing that now at the intersection of these exponential growth curves with information technology, biotechnology, and nanotechnology. And obviously, this is the kind of stuff that gets talked about at TED conferences and when people talk about the future of media and disruption and business models and whether the medium is the message and how are we distributing content. Now, the bigger picture is that media is just the beginning. It's just the first phase of things that are about to be transformed. So about a year ago, I launched a series of micro documentaries called Shots of Philosophical Espresso that explore this coevolution of humans and technology. And the goal, really, of these short films was to pull people out of context in such a dramatic manner and force them to gawk in amazement at the ubiquitous everyday wonders we're culturally disposed to ignore, because our brains are so quick to assimilate change that we stop noticing its implications. And these films took off, probably because they're only 2 minutes in length, and the attention spans today are about that size. So the first film I'd like to show you is called Radical Openness, and it premiered at the TED Global Conference. And it's an anthem to the power of ideas to change the world, which is to say, in the face of disruptive change, embrace the disruption, and remember, ideas can change the world. So let's watch the first film, Radical Openness.
You know, I love this idea of radical openness, the free exchange of information, the free flow of ideas, creating spaces in which ideas can have sex, as Matt Ridley talks about. And this is huge because it turns out that ideas are just as real as the neurons they inhabit, as James Gleick tells us. You know, a new kingdom rises above the biosphere. Denizens of this kingdom are ideas, because ideas have retained some of the properties of organisms, it turns out. They leap from brain to brain. They compete for the limited resources of our attention. They have infectivity. They have spreading power. They are what Richard Dawkins calls the new replicators, born from the primordial soup of human culture. Their vector of transmission is language and electronic communications. Though ideas are not made of nucleic acid, they have achieved more evolutionary change and at a rate that leaves the old gene panting far behind. You know, Ray Kurzweil says our ability to create virtual models in our heads combined with our modest-looking thumbs was sufficient to usher in a secondary force of evolution called technology, and it will continue until the entire universe is at our fingertips. This is unbelievable stuff. It speaks to the telescopic nature of evolutionary change. More change in the last 100 years than in the last billion years. Terence McKenna actually wrote that from the moment that human beings invented language, biological evolution essentially ceased, and evolution became a cultural epigenetic phenomenon. Now, we take in matter of low organization, we put it through our mental filters, and we extrude it in the form of space shuttles and iPhones. You know, the Imaginary Foundation tells us that what imagination does is it allows us to conceive of delightful future possibilities, pick the most amazing one, and pull the present forward to meet it. You know, imagine how impoverished this world would have been if we hadn't invented the technology of the oil painting in time for Van Gogh, or the technology of the musical instrument in time for Beethoven and Mozart to unfurl through it, you know, with the revolutions in biotechnology, nanotechnology, the free exchange of information is allowing us to conceive of radical new things. Freeman Dyson says, in the future, new generation of artists will be writing genomes with the fluency that Blake and Byron wrote verses. What is great in man, said Nietzsche, is that he is a bridge and not an end. You know, we're on a trajectory smack in the middle between the born and the made, wrote Kevin Kelly. And so, radical openness, it's huge. It's a universe of possibility. It's gray infused by color. It's the invisible revealed. It's the mundane blown away by awe. We need to cultivate radical openness as a way of participating and accelerating evolution. Wow.
Thanks, guys. You know, the reason for doing these, and these are totally non-commercial, and I did these as a sort of a passion project to reflect my existential sensibilities as I was digesting all these transformations that were happening, not just in media, but in technology as a whole. And I wanted to give people a kind of long view perspective on these ideas. I wanted these films to be like sort of equivalent to a time-lapse video that just kind of compresses everything and just gives you the whole picture, sort of like a psychedelic experience, like a digital psychedelic, and just really radically pull people out of context. But it was also an experiment in these smaller attention spans that we're dealing with today. I mean, we hear the terms the attention economy. Attention is the new limited resources. We're fighting for attention the way we've fought for oil. And this is a new reality. I read a fantastic article recently about technologies of rhetoric, technologies of attention, technologies that capture and manage attention, because only when we are completely immersed, only when we have rapt, focused attention, can any kind of interpersonal persuasion, transformation, or education take place. And in an environment increasingly saturated in media and saturated in possibilities, many of us have kind of like the vertigo or the paralysis of just, we don't know where to focus or we don't know where to put our attention. So I think increasingly, the future of media is going to be not just about creating compelling new different narratives that transcend their own formats. I mean, even a recent article by Steven Soderbergh spoke about the tyranny of narrative and how we wanted to escape the old conventions. Every new technological phase change is going to require new rules on how to tell stories, how to engage people, how to capture their imaginations, how to hold their rapt attention, because otherwise, forget about it. Nothing's going to happen. We're just going to keep suffering this bandwidth anxiety in the face of all this transformation and all this change. I know that's a lot. another sort of big message that my films try to put out there is that a lot of times people feel like their constant mediation with media, you know, with television or cable or smartphones or watching content on their smartphones, that, you know, we're living these constantly mediated lives, and people wonder whether this is just unnatural, or is the internet changing the way we think, or is the fact that we're staring at screens all day changing our brains? But I think there's an interesting alternative narrative to put out there that I'd like to throw into your heads, and that's the cognitive philosopher Andy Clark, who puts a message out there that he says, first of all, we need to get over what he calls our skin bag bias and see these technologies as extensions of ourselves, essentially our extended phenotypes. They're essentially scaffoldings, they're exoskeletons that transcend and extend our thought, our reach, and our vision. That's what human beings have always done. We use our tools to extend who we are. Language extends who we are. Sticks that we use to reach fruits on a high tree as cavemen extended our reach. Today, our smartphones represent distributed cognition, extensions of mind. And it blows my mind to think about this, because most people still think of technology as artificial. You know, there's the organic world, there's the world of the born, and then there's the world of the made. But Kevin Kelly, as my video mentioned, talks about that we should get over that the idea that there's somehow a line that divides those two things. These things fall into a continuum, and we're smack in the middle between the born and the made. So I actually made another video that's called To Understand is to Perceive Patterns. And this video looks at the analogous patterns between man-made systems and natural systems. And it showcases all the ways in which what we're finding is that increasingly the more sophisticated our technologies get, the more they start to mirror processes and patterns found in nature. So you start to see that even the most cyborg-like interfaces that we create look more and more like their natural counterparts. So let's roll the second video. To Understand is to Perceive Patterns.
To understand is to perceive patterns. Now, of course, what this means is that true comprehension comes when the dots are revealed and you get Stephen Johnson's long view and you see the big picture. This is an idea about patterns, recurring patterns across different scales of reality. You know, Paul Stamets talks about the mycelial archetype and how the information sharing systems that comprise the internet look exactly like computer models of dark matter in the universe, look exactly like the neurons in a brain. They all share the same intertwinkled filamental structure. It's the rise of networkism as big data. Advocates talk about how man-made systems are looking exactly like natural systems. The more we can measure, the more we can visualize, the more expands our consciousness by seeing these recurring patterns across scales of reality. It blows my mind, and I think that technology increasingly is becoming an expander of human consciousness. It extends our thought, reach, and vision, and revealing so much more. It's like, whereas once I was blind, now I can see. Jeffrey West from the Santa Fe Institute is telling us that cities are really like organisms. You know, alleys are like capillaries. How is it possible that a man-made artificial technological system is behaving like a natural system? The more efficient it becomes, the more it's starting to look like nature. Really interesting, weird stuff. You know, but it makes me optimistic. It's like when Steven Johnson says, look, if we can understand all this stuff, we can, I mean, anything becomes possible, right? It's the adjacent possible, standing as a sort of shadow future, a map of all the ways the present can reinvent itself. It's beautiful stuff.
You know, it's interesting. My goal has always been to get people or get us to look at ourselves the way an alien intelligence might look at us. If we were watching a National Geographic documentary about the man-machine civilization, the cybernetic organism that we are, it would be no different than when you talk about a termite and the termite colony. You know, the termite colony is temperature controlled, it's regulated, it's sophisticated, it's a part of the termite species. The bird nest is a part of the bird. The anthill is a part of the ant. I mean, you've seen how sophisticated these anthills can be when, you know, when we actually take a close look at them. And so when we think about what it means to be human in the 21st century, I'm reminded of the words of John Brockman, who wrote a wonderful essay in his website for the Edge Foundation. And he says that, you know, mankind constantly needs a new story of who and what we are. When the astronauts first took a picture of the Earth and saw Earth from the vantage point of space, we immediately, viscerally knew we had a new story. That picture was a new story of who and what we were. It was a single cybernetic system. We understood that instantly based on that photograph. And according to John Brockman, today, on the back of these exponentially emerging technologies, we are in need of a new story. What does it mean to be human today? What is a Homo sapien? Are we Homo cyberneticus? I mean, what are we today? And I like to tell people, we are our smartphones. We are our jet engines. We are the species that transcends. We didn't stay in the caves, we haven't stayed on the planet, and soon we won't stay with the limitations of our biology. Because something else that we're seeing is that these information technologies that have turned supercomputers into iPhones that are now extending our nervous systems, these information technologies are swallowing up other fields, material science, materials. Nanotechnology revolution is turning the building blocks of the physical world, atoms, into something that's programmable. Matter is now becoming programmable, and these technologies are also evolving exponentially. Biology is becoming an information technology. We're learning to master the information processes of biology. In fact, gene sequencing today is going 3 times faster than Moore's law, which dictated the exponential growth curves of our information technology-based products. So when biology becomes the new instrument for design by the artist, what are we going to make? I mean, you saw in my first video, the technology of the oil painting gave us Van Gogh. The technology of music gave us Beethoven. What is the technology of biology going to give us? How are artists and storytellers going to craft narratives made out of the materials of life, which is basically software that can write its own hardware? I mean, who knows how the apex of those converging revolutions will transform the human condition? But one thing's for sure, there's a great line by Eric Davis who says, at some point, the human design process will achieve a sort of infinite velocity. Everything will become linked with everything else, and matter becomes mind. People talk about the Internet of Things. They talk about extending our nervous systems out into the world. When the whole world starts to respond to the mind, the distinction between us and world will grow flimsy indeed. So I want to leave you with one last video. It's called The Beginning of Infinity. It's inspired by David Deutsch's new book. And you know, you've all read the bumper sticker, Mind Over Matter. This is meant to take that to a very literal level with a wonderful example of how the topography of Manhattan is a great example of mind trumping geology, shaping the topography of a physical space based on the decisions of minds. So let's watch The Beginning of Infinity. Last video.
2, 1, 0.
I am very much an optimist. I'm reminded of Rich Doyle's line from Darwin's Pharmacy. He says, dreams do not lack reality. They are real patterns of information. When the Imaginary Foundation says that the role of human imagination is to conceive of all these delightful futures, choose the most amazing and exciting and ecstatic possibility, and then pull the present forward to meet it. That is what we do. We bring our imaginings into existence, but I think that as technology has advanced, have found ways to outsource our mental capacities to our tools so much more. Our ability to manipulate the physical world has increased in an exponential fashion. So we've been able to shrink the lag time between our imaginings and their instantiation in the real world. David Deutsch speaks in his new book, The Beginning of Infinity. He says, if you look at the topography of the island of Manhattan today, that topography is a topography in which the forces of economics and culture and human intent have trumped the forces of geology. I mean, the topography of Manhattan today is no longer shaped by mere geology. It's shaped by the human mind and by economics and by culture. And so what David Deutsch extrapolates is that ultimately that will be the fate of the whole universe. He says gravitation and antimatter might only shape the universe at its earliest and least interesting stages, but eventually the whole entire thing will be subject to the intent of substrate-independent, infinitely more powerful minds. And to conceive of that just, it makes me feel ecstatic.
Thank you so much, guys. You know, when they told me that the theme was beyond disruption, I thought, how much further beyond, you know? And so I thought I'd take you there. But ultimately, I call my talk The Currency of Inspiration. What I'm really trying to do is to take that thing called inspiration, that fleeting thing defined by its impermanence, and try to eternalize it, try to immortalize it. You know, to take my existential angst and turn it into like a real physical thing that can be shared. So I hope you guys have been invigorated by these philosophical espresso shots, and thank you for your attention. Have a great day. Thank you.
Awesome. Show your invigoration for Jason Silva. Woo! What'd you guys think? Was that riveting? Was that awesome? All right, you can hang out here. Yeah, a round of applause for sure. Who has any thoughts or questions following? I mean, not that I have answers. We're going to open up for a discussion in between the two visionary speeches. Does anybody have any thoughts from that? What was your big takeaway? I'm running to you. What's your big takeaway? Do we need more coffee? Is that what's going on? That's fair. Awesome. So how many people went to the NATPE birthday party last night? Yeah? Who danced until the wee hours of the morning last night? Awesome. So we're just a couple minutes away from our next speaker taking the stage. And so what you want to do is, while these folks are talking, that write down any questions or thoughts you may have, because we'll have a discussion afterwards. I thought Jason's talk was really like out there and thought-provoking, right? Like, wow, we're all connected, all the patterns, how it all connects up, and wow, the future is...